Everyone's got to vote based upon the good versus the bad, and some very ugly.
Your voice, your tax dollars. The Senate Deputy Majority Leader is with us to give us the lowdown on the new state spending plan. Thanks for joining us. I'm Julia Locadee. Hi, Senator.
How are you?
Good. How are you doing?
Well, I got some rest after our all-nighter.
Very good.
I haven't done that since college, but it was kind of a dysfunctional final night and a half, and it was very difficult on everybody. And it got done, and it got done sort of on time, maybe a few hours late. But there's a lot of things we've got to talk about in this budget.
Can you give us any sort of inside look into something that's not either widely known about the process or state government this session?
Well, the process was not known at all this year, and there's been a lot of criticism that everything was done by and behind closed doors. And I think what happened is the negotiations really didn't get going on in earnest for the last couple of weeks. We didn't have the public conference committees between the Assembly and the Senate, which we are supposed to do. And everything truly was done behind closed doors. To a certain extent, it has to be. You know, people say three men in a room. But the fact is there were some knockdown, drag-out discussions in the Republican conference. There was a big difference as to what some people wanted in this budget and what other people wanted and the others didn't want. So it's not just three people in a room. It's actually some serious discussions for many, many hours as to what our position should be and how active we should pursue that position. So from that extent, all the legislators participated, at least in the Senate and the Senate conferences. There should have been more public knowledge as to what was really going on. Even when the three leaders came out of the leader meeting, very little was said till the last week. Very little was said. Very vague. Sometimes there wasn't even anything said. So it was. We knew what was going on. The Republican conference knew what was going on, and I'm sure the Democrat conference did in the Assembly, the majority there. But the general public was kind of not sure exactly where it stood at any point in time.
Let's take our viewers out to the Senate floor for a vote.
Many speakers thus far have mentioned many of the deficiencies in the bill, things that aren't in there that they would like to have in there, and things that are in there that they don't like, but on balance, it's something they should vote for. I just want to make it very clear that the minority members of this House are in that position. And I want you to know that the majority members in this House are in the exact position. For example, one of the things that many of us want, and many people who have come to Albany want, was a tax credit for private parochial schools in order to provide that additional education option and to make it affordable, especially since that's much cheaper than trying to make more public schools to take care of those kids. So many of us are very, very disappointed about that. Many of us hate, not dislike, hate other things that are in the budget that we believe very strongly are going to hurt the economy. But we're all in the same dilemma. We're all in the same space here, that there is a bill has so many things in it and may be omitting many, many things that we've all got to weigh whether the good outweighs the bad, because we don't have the choice of voting on each individual item the way the bill was presented to all of us. So I guess the main point I want to make is that that concern by the minority is not an exclusive minority concern. It definitely is a concern of the majority as well. So I guess the point is that everybody has to look at this bill and weigh the good with the bad and decide what the best thing to do based upon the bill as it exists, and fight the fight another day for those things that maybe we can't control in view of the fact that it's part of one big bill.
Well, that's kind of rare, isn't it, for the Republican Party? They always seem so united.
Well, it was a very difficult budget. I mean, this the governor presented a very progressive, and I think it's more appropriately called regressive budget that's going to be regressive to the economy, because there's a lot of additional costs, minimum wage, paid family leave on businesses, and in some of these instances, it's going to be devastating because, for example, the paid family leave isn't a bill that carves out small businesses like a 10-person business. So if you have two people that have tragedies in their family, that they could get up to 4 months after they've worked for the company to take care of these tragedies, and you have two of them and you're a 10-person operation, what's going to happen is going to be very difficult, I believe, to find replacement employees for a short period of time like that that could do the job. And second, what's going to end up, I think, is all the small business owners are going to end up spending, instead of 60 hours a week, 80 hours a week, or deciding to cut back on the type of work they do and go smaller. There's a lot of things. The minimum wage increase is split along regional lines. There's a phase-in with respect to upstate, but still, it's a real burden. After increasing the minimum wage over the last 3 years by 24%, which is 24% higher than the minimum wage, what this does over the next 5 or 6 years increases the minimum wage to $15. Now, I didn't really intend to dwell on that, but when I'm talking about the big, the bad, and the ugly, and that same bill was a record increase in school aid and getting rid of this special tax on really urban and rural and suburban school district, the gap elimination adjustment. And we got rid of that, and which was extremely important to school districts and the property tax payers, because if you can't get the money from the state, you're going to end up increasing property taxes. So it was a mishmash of so many different things, so that's what I was lamenting about. I guess it looked like a lament when I was watching it. I didn't realize I seemed that down when I was speaking. But that's what was going on. There's real good things here, and we stopped some things.
Yeah.
Like the DREAM Act. I mean, we're sometimes playing defense more than offense, and we stopped the DREAM Act, which would have given college tuition benefits or monies to pay college tuition to illegal immigrants when our citizens can't afford college and end up with huge debt. We stopped a SUNY tuition increase, which would have been devastating with the high cost of higher education. It would increase those loans even further. We raised the age. In my mind, that's most states have it, increasing between criminal responsibility from 16 years old up to 18 years old. But it requires a whole different dealing with the kids between 16 and 18, and the details are not complete yet. And just to pass it because it's a good phrase and it may be a good policy without the corresponding changes as to how it's going to be implemented, that was extremely important. So that's what was going on during that session, ended up the way it did.
Yeah, there was a resemblance of the middle class tax plan, a big resemblance to what the Senate Republicans wanted.
Exactly, and that was an excellent thing, because the middle class tax increase, many didn't know it, that we passed about 3 years ago was set to expire next year. So it would have been a tax increase. Mm-hmm. So what the Republicans, I think, and we were the ones pushing for it, is the assembly was pushing for a millionaire tax increase. But we not only extended that tax, so it's not going to expire. But we also reduced the bracket you're in. In other words, reduce the percentage off of your adjusted gross income that you pay, so it's a lower tax cost. So that was good. It's phased in. Of course it's phased in. You can't make that kind of change in 1 year. But on the other hand, I think that was an excellent proposal. So it's, as I said, there's good and there's bad, but it made it very difficult this year for a lot of people.
You are the floor leader during the debates. And just to give the viewers an idea, more of an idea of the process, let's take a look at this.
I just want to make an announcement throughout this building and wherever else senators might be. We try to do this in a logical way by giving people a little time to get something to eat. We're supposed to be back at 7:15. There's a lot of us here, but there is also a lot of empty seats. So if you'd like to come back, it would be helpful. It's the earlier we get done tonight rather than be here to some ungodly hour. So please, pretty please, if anybody hears this message that's either a senator or someone that knows where a senator is, will you please send them down now?
You know, I'm making light of it, but it is so frustrating. We purposely took a break of 45 minutes in order to go get something to eat. That was provided in the Capitol. It wasn't that we had to go 6 miles to get it. Just about 500 feet. And it was, you try to do things in an organized fashion. Many, many of the senators were there, many ready to go, so we wouldn't go all through the night, which we ended up doing, by the way. And the delinquent senators just come strolling in when they expect to come strolling in, but you can't organize that way. After that message, I'm happy to say people came in, and so we got moving. But that's true with every vote. It used to be that if you wanted to vote yes on a bill, you didn't have to be present. You only had to be present if you wanted to vote no. And then one of the great reforms we made, I always talk about reforms, is that you got to be present in the chamber to vote either way, and that makes sense. But if that's the rule, then be there. And so that's what that was all about.
There are so many details to this. DeFrancisco.NYsenate.gov has the breakdown. So tell us what's left on the table for the rest of the session.
Well, there's a lot of things on the table. Some of the things I mentioned already that were not in the budget, mm-hmm. We're going to be pushing for the private parochial school tax credit. We're going to be pushing, we'd be pushing for some of my top priorities that weren't in the budget. And one was we're spending tens of millions of dollars to remediate kids in college rather than make sure they're prepared when they get out of high school. And I had a pilot program in the budget, in the Senate budget, one house budget, that would have done that, started at an urban school in New York City, a school in New York City, one in Long Island, one in upstate New York. And just get everything in gear so we see how it works. I'm sure it'll work, but at least get it going. And that wasn't in there. There's another top priority that was just ignored, and we talked about it many times on the show, and that is the indigent legal services a case that was settled by the governor. There was five counties that said the state is required to pay these expenses, not the counties. And the governor agreed, and they came up with a solution. What the formula was what had to be paid. But what about the other 57? We have an obligation, if that's the deal that the government's made, why should it only apply to five because they litigate? Because mm-hmm. we always talk about, well, it's too much litigation. Well, if they didn't litigate, they wouldn't be paid by the state, which they should. So now what we've done by not doing anything about it is simply almost give an incentive to litigate for the other 57 counties. And there's going to be very difficult for the state to change their position. So we're wasting a lot of money in litigation. Just do it. Mm. It was agreed to do it for everybody. But the argument was, well, we don't have enough money. Well, then you should have thought of that when you settled the lawsuit. Mm. But apparently everything gets, you don't worry about it now, you worry about it later.
kind of fits into the category of social justice.
Yes, yes it does.
And economic justice. Thank you so much for being with us, Senator.
Well, thank you.
And thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator John DeFrancisco. For additional information on what we discussed today, DeFrancisco.NYsenate.gov.